Screen News Digest is brought to you as a public service by Pepsi-Cola of Birmingham, Alabama. Space, the final frontier. And like most frontiers, space has been man's domain. After six Mercury flights, 10 Gemini, 11 Apollos, 3 Skylabs, and numerous Soyuz, Cosmos, and Vostoks, only two women have ever ventured into space. Both were Russians, and both little more than Soviet-style Barbie dolls. Neither had any technical skills or scientific training. They were merely along for the ride, allowing TASS, the Russian news service, to boast, "A brilliant star has flared up in the cosmic firmament. Never and in no country did women ever attain such height." Perhaps, but in the United States, space remained an exclusive male domain. It was American men who first walked in space and then set the first human footprints on a planet other than Earth. And subsequent flights have remained a sort of free-floating bachelor party. Until now.
Main stage, 4, 3, 2, 1, ignition!
America's first women astronauts are soaring into space as flight engineers and mission specialists aboard the space shuttle. From 1960 until 1977, for reasons that will forever remain unclear, NASA was unable to find a single qualified woman candidate. Then, after examining 8,000 applicants for the shuttle program, 29 men and 6 women were selected as astronaut candidates, among them Sally Ride and Judy Resnick. The first American woman to venture into space will be Dr. Sally K. Ride. Height, 5 feet 5, weight, 115 pounds, brown hair, blue eyes, a description that might well fit thousands of young women today. But Sally Ride's vital statistics include a string of academic credentials that at first glance seem to belong to three people. At Stanford University, she simultaneously earned degrees in English and physics, then a master's and PhD in physics, specializing in astrophysics. When first notified of her selection in 1978, Ride immediately called her family.
They're almost as excited as I am. My mother's reaction was that I have another sister who's in theology. She's at a theological seminary. And my mother said, well, you know, one of the two of them's going to get to heaven.
For Dr. Judy Resnick, a graduate of Carnegie Mellon with a PhD in electrical engineering from the University of Maryland, becoming an astronaut was an almost inevitable step.
I decided to apply to be an astronaut when I was a graduate student finishing up my research work. It was not something that I had planned to do for my whole life. It was a case of being in the right place at the right time. NASA was advertising for astronauts at the time that I was looking for a job.
But flying jobs, until recently, have almost always belonged to men. Of course, women were allowed in the air, but nobody dreamed they would actually be able to fly the plane. Save for an occasional woman such as Amelia Earhart, who made daring solo flights across the Atlantic and parts of the Pacific before being lost on a round-the-world flight in 1937. But for the most part, women were trained to fly as stewardesses, not pilots. And when visionaries such as Jules Verne began to dream that spaceflight was even possible, they peopled their fantasies with male astronauts. In this 1903 version of Jules Verne's A Trip to the Moon, movie pioneer George Melly used women as decorative accessories who never left the ground. As America moved into the space age, its first astronauts were monkeys, males, of course. Such monkey business led Jerry Cobb, an America's foremost woman pilot, to comment bitterly, "NASA won't let me take the actual training course, but I see they have a chimpanzee who is being trained to take it." Then in 1959, seven astronauts were chosen for America's first manned spaceflight program, dubbed Mercury. Understandably, NASA's first candidates were military test pilots and, of course, men. They were, after all, little more than human cannonballs who would be fired into space and brought back to Earth by ground control. Surely a job for Superman and not Lois Lane.
Arm light on.
Switching command to internal.
By 1965, spaceflight had become complicated. A two-man capsule, part of the Gemini program, was launched. And in Gemini, the astronauts were actually to fly the vehicle and to make daringly beautiful walks in space. All this, of course, was preparation for the Apollo mission, which would set men on the moon. Now, women astronauts are being trained alongside their male counterparts, and NASA had to deal with the obvious differences in male-female anatomy. Would they have to redesign the shuttle capsule to accommodate those differences? It turned out only the spacesuits had to be made smaller to fit the smaller female form. And with the increasing number of jobs to be done in space, a new type of astronaut, the mission specialist, has evolved.
The mission specialist does things associated with the experiments on board or deploying the satellites, while the pilots do most of the flying of the orbiter. On the mission that I've been assigned to, the mission specialist will be doing work on deploying a communication satellite, which will be done from the panels behind me.
One of Dr. Ride's on-orbit jobs will be to manipulate the arm, this super-sophisticated 50-foot crane. Articulated like a giant human arm, it will launch and retrieve objects in space, like a shortstop, fielding and throwing a ball. Astronaut training is as physically demanding as any sport. For Ride, who as a teenager had been a nationally ranked junior tennis player and who still runs 5 miles a day, it is no problem. Meetings are a constant feature of astronaut training, as is flying. In Air Force T-38 jet trainers, Ride, Resnick, and the other mission specialists learn radio and navigational systems. In flight, prospective astronauts are introduced to G-forces, the increasing pull of gravity on the body during a rapid climb or pull out from a dive that can cause the inexperienced to black out. For Sally Ride, the experience proved so exhilarating, she went on and learned to fly and now holds a private pilot's license. Of course, what goes up must eventually come down, even spacecraft. And so astronaut training is filled with ups and downs. And in the event the vehicle must land in the water, the astronauts must learn to get their feet wet. In simulators such as this, NASA can reproduce virtually every moment of the shuttle's flight. From blast off to orbit, every sequence of the flight is generated by computers that feed readings into the exact replica of the shuttle's complex instrument panels. The idea is to prepare for any eventuality so that no matter what happens, the astronauts will react instantly and correctly. After simulation comes the real thing. For Dr. Ride, it begins with her selection as a CAPCOM, capsule communicator, the only person on the ground to communicate directly with the shuttle astronauts in orbit. It's an awesome responsibility, but Ride is not above a little fun.
Is that the vampire that goes with the red blood cells?
I like that.
But nothing on Earth can quite match the experience of weightlessness that is the quintessential physical condition of spaceflight. The closest NASA can come is in the cargo bay of a C-135, the Air Force's giant jet cargo plane. If even a few seconds of weightlessness can lead to euphoria, parachute training can bring one down to Earth very quickly. Now spaceflight has become even more complicated, and the space shuttle has become NASA's workhorse. Dr. Resnick.
The shuttle is a very versatile tool. We can do experiments on orbit. We can repair satellites that might have malfunctioned or changed their film packs. We can study the stars and look outward. We can study the Earth and look back down.
There are advantages in almost every field of science. Astrophysics, it's obvious. X-rays don't make it through the atmosphere, so you have to be in space to do any experimentation at all. There are any number of things that you might be able to learn in physiology about the human body that just the way that it reacts to weightlessness, I'm sure will be very important. Materials processing.
Materials processing in space involves understanding and studying how materials combine. For example, if you can put metals together and make different types of alloys, and their properties are different if they're manufactured without gravity than they are in gravity.
If we date the space program from 1957, the year the Russians launched Sputnik, to the moment when STS-7, the space shuttle Challenger, lifts off with astronaut Dr. Sally K. Ride aboard, it will have taken women 26 years to finally get into space. Was it worth it? Why the desperate desire to leave the Earth? To challenge the vast unknown of space. Dr. Ride.
Well, for one thing, it's there. I mean, you have to do it.
And as the space shuttle Challenger lifts off with Dr. Sally K. Ride among its astronauts, America truly enters the space age.
Screen News Digest has been brought to you as a public service by Pepsi-Cola, Birmingham, Alabama.